few questions on that. Okay, so I'll leave it to Kat and then we'll come up and we'll come round and ask you a few questions after you. Okay.
Yeah,
thank
sorry, you. I can't speak, but I'm on my call. I just wanted to start by saying thanks very much for inviting me. I kind of wanted to start by talking a little bit about the Radical Independence Campaign. We set that up 5 years ago in a tiny wee room above Central Station in Glasgow. It's about 10 of us, all under the age of 30. You know, an assorted bunch of mad lefties and feminists and trots, all just sitting down to think, what are we going to do about the crisis that's coming for the British state? And we never for one second thought that that campaign would capture parts of the popular imagination in the way it did. We were used to being outsiders, to being on the fringes, and I think often, but maybe that's something that made us quite interesting. We certainly weren't the suited and booted types that Better Together managed to wheel out in case we were actually dealing with public from nowhere. And today I kind of want to focus on what I think is the most important thing that we need to be focusing on, and that's the idea of winning. As a trade unionist and feminist and socialist in Scotland, being for independence, I'm not used to talking about winning very often, but I think we need to give it a go. I'm also not a political expert. I don't consider myself a strategist, and I definitely don't have a crystal ball. All I can share is my experiences and where I think we've been, where we are just now, and to know these things in order to work out where we're going. So when we set up Radical Independence, it was for two main reasons. We wanted to present a different style of campaigning, something that was optimistic and focused on the missing millions rather than middle class swing voters. And given the stalemate that existed at Westminster, we had three parties committed to more and more austerity. We wanted to go out and speak to the most marginalised people in Scottish society and convince them that a vote for independence was a revolt against everything that Westminster had done to our communities for generations. We wanted to persuade people that this referendum was about an opportunity that Scotland had to repeat the same mistakes that Westminster had. And obviously we did that. You know, it was very visual and we did mass canvases and we tapped on, you know, hundreds of doors, thousands of doors, like many people in this room will have done as well. But it wasn't for us just about getting the working class out to vote. We recognised that our efforts in that campaign would be pointless unless afterwards independence genuinely improved the lives of the working class majority in Scotland. Now, at the time, at the beginning of that first referendum campaign, a lot of the SNP leadership made positive mood music about addressing the inequalities that Westminster had brought, but looking at some of the policies and reading the white paper, there was no guarantees that that would have reduced inequality. And I think that the white paper actually gave a gift to some of the unionists. I watched them go into working class areas and say, this isn't about, you know, another Scotland is possible, this is about corporation tax cuts for the rich. I watched them use it against us. For Radical Independence, we wanted to move away from that tribal party politics and establish a united front for Scotland that could use its resources and influence for the poorest in Scotland and the poorest internationally as well. We insisted that we needed a movement broad enough to capture party critics, as well as party loyalists, as well as people who had never been engaged in politics before. And we saw that most of the independence movement wanted a break from that neoliberal tax-cutting approach, and we wanted to give everyone who agreed with that, even in the broadest sense, a home to go to, a campaign that they could be part of. But I'm not here today just to repeat the arguments that we made in Radical Independence. I'm just going to try and draw on those experiences as much as possible. And I want to focus on three things that I think we need to discuss today in order to talk about that concept of winning. Firstly, and although it seems ridiculously obvious, I think we have to say over and over and over again, this is 2017. This is not 2014. This is not 2012. It feels almost like 100 years of political upheaval have been squeezed into the last 5, and the conditions of the future future referendum will take place will be so markedly different to what's happened before, and we cannot afford just to get the band back together. In fact, it's so dangerous to our chances of success. Let me explain. So Radical Independence's approach worked in 2014. We assessed some of the problems in the Yes campaign and we tried to put forward that different message. But like I said, 2017 is a different year, very, very different. I mean, you know, 3 years on, the Labour Party leadership is sympathetic to some of the things that Radical Independence were saying, even though we don't agree on the constitution. There's still some sympathy there, which I would never have thought would have happened. Labour in Scotland and in the UK is also much, much weaker. In Scotland, of course, they're nowhere, and now the opposition in Scotland is centre-right and deeply British nationalist, right to its very core. Now, the Scottish Government looks strong, and the SNP looks invincible in elections, but I think we need to think about for how long. Many pundits perceive that if Scotland can't break and get independence, then over a long enough timeline, the SNP's sense of invincibility will begin to crumble and the Tories will be waiting to pounce. So one option here is just to batten down the hatches and stay in government as long as possible and, you know, err on the side of caution. But I think that the current political trend that we are seeing all over the world is that voters are out to punish political insiders, the people that they see as being in charge. That's why old social democratic parties are failing across the world, because they're sticking to, you know, standard economic and political formulas. And I think that that is a potential, a serious potential danger for us. And in case I'm misunderstood, it is the right that is seizing that argument and taking advantage of the fact that voters want to punish the political elites. Another marked difference for me in 2017 compared to where we were when we set up Radical Independence is that we were riding on a wave of anti-austerity sentiment. We had the possibility of Syriza in Greece. We had Podemos riding high. You know, there was already the start of the Sanders campaign. There was already Occupy that had happened in the United States. We were riding on a wave that people genuinely thought anti-austerity politics were possible. Now, with the collapse of Syriza, that's no longer possible in people's political imaginations. Right now, it's the right wing that have the banner of protest. That's why people like Trump and Farage are winning. And I think if we don't reclaim that banner of protest, we'll suffer the same fate as other political establishments around the world. We'll all be punished regardless of whether you're SNP, Green, Socialist, regardless of who's to blame, we'll all suffer. I think we need a new, reinvigorated, anti-establishment Yes movement to outflank that right wing. That might mean being openly critical of the Scottish Government as well as being openly critical of those that oppose us. I don't expect that to be the most popular person in the room. Once you've been the question, then you can get used to it. The second point I want to make is that we will not win this referendum if we make it about Europe. Now, I understand why people support a European project. You know, if it didn't exist, we'd probably have to invent it. But the problem is that the European Union is now so embedded in a path of neoliberalism, of that established political and economic doctrine, that I don't think it's reformable. I think it's unreformable and undemocratic, and I think we need something better. Now, assuming we're actually granted permission to have a referendum, I think we can win it, but I think we need to look exactly where our people are in order to do that. Now, many commentators had said that the 2014 loss of independence would demoralise and destroy us, but, you know, 3 years on, we can see that that just hasn't happened, and that meetings like this are still happening, and they're still happening across Scotland. Our support has remained stubborn and consistent at little less than half of the population, and our side are motivated by that. The other side is confused. I mean, I think the whole thing's hilarious, just watching them all like scurrying around. I mean, the whole thing is a mess. But the majority of Scotland, I think, knows that this idea of stability of the status quo, it just isn't an option anymore. By concentrating everything on the European Union, we've taken a very dangerous gamble. And I urge the Yes campaign, it's a broad movement, all of those different groups, to be broad and inclusive and mindful of the 38% of people who voted to leave, the 38% of yes voters who voted to leave, because we need them. I wrote about this recently in the National, about the Scottish Social Action Survey. Now, it's the most authoritative of its kind, and it shows some of the advantages that we've got in terms of where people are actually at, but it also highlights some warnings. It shows that, you know, the part of Scotland who prefer independence to other constitutional options has doubled since 2012. It shows, for the first time since the survey began, there are more people who back full-on independence than people that want a modified version of devolution, like the devo max option. A full 80% of the country wants full Scottish sovereignty or full control over everything apart from defence and foreign affairs. So 80% of people in favour of something like home rule. So maybe 2014 didn't, like, you know, we didn't win then, but it's proved a completely defining moment. That 45% is in some way stable, but it's stuck. And I think that we need to remember that going from when the referendum was first called and the, you know, support for Scottish independence being at the 25% to go to the 45%, it was a plurality of vision. It was many, many different yeses. One giant no to Westminster and the establishment and to the status quo, but many different voices for yes, and that was our strength. These are all good things for our movement to know. But I also think it's important to recognise that all the evidence and lots of different surveys, including the Scottish Social Action Survey, says that despite 62% of Scotland backing Remain, there has been little real change in attitudes towards independence since the Brexit vote. Basically, we've still got 45% plus a little bit backing yes, but that material change in circumstances with Brexit hasn't boosted our side. We haven't seen that huge swell of support. And I think that there's some answers in some of these polls that have been done. In the Social Attitude Survey, it showed that Scotland is increasingly more than a tad Eurosceptic. When devolution started, we had a full 38% of Scotland who wanted to increase the EU's powers. Today, it's just 8%. In 1999, only 40% of Scotland wanted to leave the EU or reduce its powers. Today, it's more than two-thirds. In that sense, Scotland's attitudes to Europe aren't necessarily that distinct from the rest of the UK. Now, John Curtis looked into this, and he found that that was partly to do with Scotland's vote to remain in the EU was to do with two factors, and that's the voters weren't really voting on the EU. You know, in Scotland, we had all our politicians voting up to back Remain, and that does have an impact on people's consciousness, apart from a few weirdo Tories. You know, pretty much everyone, you know, in the political centre was backing Remain. And that, do you know what I mean, that boosted the Remain vote in Scotland. But there's also another aspect to that, and it was something that I found when I was going out and speaking to people, you know, just casually about Europe, because I didn't campaign on it, I didn't even vote. So when I was out speaking to people who are deeply sceptical about Europe were saying, I'll be voting Remain so I'm not trapped on this bloody island with them in charge, and people saw it as a buffer. And we need to be mindful of the fact that there are people who still have deep concerns about the European Union and the way that it's run. We can pick up maybe some votes from people who voted Remain, who voted no last time. But I think that the people who most ardently back the European Union, people in boardrooms, people who run corporations, these are the people who are overwhelmingly backers of Europe. And that means for me that in a second referendum, we can't focus all of our energies on the idea of the European Union. And so I want to come to my third point, which is the third thing that I think we need to think about if we're going to win. Now, this kind of relates to my first, that it's not 2014 anymore, you know, we have moved on. But I want to go into a bit more detail about that. So, firstly, the unionist forces, like I said, look very, very different. Labour will not lead a no campaign in Europe and Scotland. They will not be able to do that. They won't be able to sign up, you know, to lead a Better Together Mark II, and they'll probably run something, you know, embarrassing and quiet, kind of like the radical campaign. The Tories will dominate the issue of opposition to independence. I can see it now being led by someone like Ruth Davidson, who looks like an outsider Tory, who could be an anti-establishment Tory, and that's worrying. The thing that makes me most worried about it is that the Yes campaign doesn't look like a group of outsiders anymore. That's what bothers me. In fact, pro-independence politicians are now an overwhelming majority in nearly every single tier of our institutions, and I don't expect that to change with the council elections that are coming up. So we can't rely on this idea of a protest vote turning out like you did in 2014. We had to earn the credibility last time, but we'll have to earn it again. And I think, as the election last year showed, and I felt this quite sharply, there is no guarantee that the radical yes vote is a permanent factor in politics. Because we didn't change Scotland forever. The housing schemes that turned out in huge numbers for the referendum stayed at home last year. So what do we take from that? Well, I want to start with my kind of own everyday experience. And I was saying to John, picking me up from the station last night, and got in quite late, and I had to get a later train because I was working with a work full time at the moment. I'm working for a trade union. I work as a trade union organiser. And what I do in my job every day is try and get people to organise in their workplaces together and to protest against conditions that are harming them in terms of their material conditions, in terms of the way they feel about their work, when they feel alone and powerless. I try to get them to organise together to change that. And in a way, it's far tougher than some of the political campaigning that I've done, because people still feel like they have some, at least limited influence over parliaments, even if they still seem really remote. But at work, people are getting shafted, and they're getting used to it. And that's the most dangerous thing of all, is that people genuinely have low expectations, and it demotivates people. When people expect to be shafted by their boss, by the establishment, it damages our capacity to organise and challenge it. And I think our job as a movement needs to be about raising people's expectations, telling people that alienation, disempowerment, and low wages and precarious work is not the best that they can expect. And in the unions, I've learned a lot of lessons about how to not organise people. I've seen old formulas reused and recycled over and over again, and I've seen decline. But I've also seen the beginning of some recovery. The way that we've been doing things in the union is starting to change, and we're getting to grips with some of our own mistakes. And I'm starting to see examples of good organising, and when I see it, I think that there are lessons there for the Yes movement too. Organising people, in my view, will fail when we just get the same familiar faces in a room over and over again. When we put the same faces, and I include my own in this, on panels, when we hear the same messages, put the same way, and go home. That's what trade unions and socialist organisations have done for generations, and it's failed. When I speak to people in workplaces, I'm looking for people who can motivate others to action. I'm looking for people who have networks and links of communication with people that we can't reach, that I can't reach. And I want them to be able to present and express an idea that when people stand up and stand together for a common interest, that they can actually change things. And I think that that chimes with what we want with independence. And when I try to get people in a workplace to discover that sense, that's for me about Scotland too. The idea that acting collectively in a common interest to change our lives for the better brings a sense of dignity. It brings confidence. It raises people's eyes and it raises their expectations. It gets people to look beyond what's happening in the next year, the next 2 years, and look right onto the horizon and see what's actually possible. And that confidence brings with it a swagger in your step. It means that you know that you can run things better than the baddest boss, that you can run things better than any politician, that you can run things better than any monarch, any head of state. And that confidence is so powerful in motivating people to go forward, to go out and speak to other people that they know who are not convinced about things, to change their minds. So 5 years ago, when we started Radical Independence, we tried to do that. You know, we tried to get people who were not familiar faces, who were not seen as leaders in politics, whether it's party politics or activism. You know, someone that we had at our first conference was someone like Jean Arpin, and she'd just left the SNP over NATO, and she was a dissident. And Jean wasn't a well-kept face, but it was important to have that new voice on our platforms. And the other people who were there from, you know, disability groups, from student campaigns, you know, from the LGBT movement, from the feminist groups, these were all new people. They weren't necessarily the loudest, but they were people with networks, people who were trusted by groups of people that the independence campaign weren't able to touch. They had knowledge and insight that hadn't got a hearing in a mainstream campaign, and it burst a bubble. Radical independence burst a bubble, and I think we need to break out of our own bubble again. We can't lose that sense that we had before of renewal and freshness in the movement. The left and the centre left, it starts to look like the same old faces, even though there is new talent and potential everywhere. I speak to people every day who are just changing their minds, you know, opening up to the idea of independence, whereas before they thought it wasn't for them. And we can't forget those lessons. They're absolutely crucial in getting us to that stage where we might win. Otherwise, if it's the same faces, our networks will get thinner and thinner. Our vision won't expand, and we'll lose that ability to build and grow people's confidence. So this was why I was saying it's dangerous just to get the band back together. We need to find new voices and new experiences, new trusted people who maybe haven't found the confidence to speak out. There are people in this room who will be in that situation, and there are people in this room who have also got a lot of skill and experience in doing political activity. So if you can write, then show someone else how you do it and build their confidence. If you can do public speaking, then take someone aside and help them draft a speech if they've never spoken in public before and give them the confidence to take it forward. We need to give away some of our own power and control in our own groups, in our campaigns, in our movement, and bring in new people who can refresh and renew our ideas for the next time round. I'll finish on this. In 2014, Rick focused on a class-based message. You know, he said, it's a working class vote, etc, etc. I'm kind of like, I feel like I've got to kind of go back to that and talk about what I mean. Because when I say like working class, I do get people whose eyes are like, here she goes again. What I mean by that is that this is the majority of people who have to work every day and technically have no choice over whether they have to work. You know, it's people who do not have, you know, acres of land and loads of properties where they just sit back and get rich off other people's labour or other people's need for land and shelter. That's a 1%. When I talk about the working class, I'm talking about the 99%. And that's why it's important, because they're the kind of super majorities that we're going to need to win. And we focused on, you know, the most disadvantaged sections of the working class, people who've been battered by austerity time and time again. But there were still people who did not vote yes that we need to win to our side next time. People in public sector workplaces, people in semi-skilled work, in factories, in shipyards. Many working women just weren't convinced by our arguments. I don't think we're ever going to win the elite managers, oil dealers, hedge fund types to our cause, because they weren't convinced by tax cuts the first time, and they're not going to be convinced next time. Now, these are the people who opposed devolution. They funded Better Together. They won't come with us, and bribing them with more tax cuts or other ways to consolidate their wealth and power is a complete dead end. So let's look to where we can win. Working people across the world are being won to an anti-establishment protest message, because the centre of politics is a failure. Like I said, right now, it's the right that are capturing that sentiment and winning with it. So we need to get out and get organised and, you know, build on our networks and likes in order to convince people that change is possible. And it's really nice to, you know, be back on like the indie trail. It's really good, and it's great to see these meetings are happening again. But I also think we need to remember that the world is changing fast, and the next time round we've got to be nimble and renewed and dynamic with new voices and new faces. Because let's not forget, we've got here on a movement of protest that put new voices centre stage. And if we remember these lessons, then next time we can win. And I really like this quote, and don't worry, it's not Marx. I'm telling Marx's Gramsci. He says that every human being has the capacity to lead people's thoughts. Every single human being has that capacity. So every time that you meet someone, always be thinking about who is this person? Who can they speak to? What kind of leadership do they have? Because everyone has that ability. And ultimately, it's those insights and knowledge of millions of people that will make sure we win next time. If we use our experience properly, seek out diverse voices, capture the idea of protest, and reflect the real working class majority of our society, then that's when we can begin to win. Thank you.